Thank you, Nico. Thanks for having me. Thank you, Klaus. Perhaps I give more words to my background. I worked in Klaus' group from, I think, 2001 to 2006, something like this. This region is, yeah, to some extent, similar to me. We worked here in the Franklinstraße. We were a building which already broke down, what I heard, what's happening in Berlin. And yes, I'm glad to be back. I'm glad to be back with such a cool stuff, I will tell you. And welcome. I will, the first time, talk about what we call XLSTM. I gave some other talks, but there it was not published. So, what I have done, it was very vague, not clear. For you, I prepared formulas. I know you're super smart, and you only believe me if I show you formulas. And I colored the formulas. But I will start with some general overview. Does it work? It does work. AI, what is AI? I always use definition. It's from Baron Feigenbaum, 1981. AI is a machine that shows cognitive function like humans. AI is always defined what humans can do, such as learning, machine learning in my field, planning, reasoning, problem solving, and which came late, it was not in the original definition, skill acquisition. The term AI was coined by John McCarthy at the workshop in 1956. And after this, there was a lot in symbolic AI. Symbolic AI is expert systems, knowledge graphs, formal systems. And success stories would be Deep Blue, this system from IBM has beaten Kasparov, the chess world champion. And then IBM Watson, which won a game show in US, Jeopardy. It's about questions you have to answer for knowledge or different fields. And there's the other direction, it's sub-symbolic AI. And I will come to the sub-symbolic AI. Prominent representatives are AlphaFold and, yes, ChatGPT.
I never heard the term sub-symbolic AI. We usually just call it neural networks. Could you maybe say one or two sentences why you're calling sub-symbolic AI?
I go to the next slide. it's better so contrast to if you say you have symbolic AI and you have neural networks, this terminology is not on the same level. It's better you say say symbolic AI, which is abstraction symbols, and sub-symbolic where you have vectors, real numbers, stuff like this. But it's better to call it like this, because if you say symbolic AI in neural networks, what is then support vector machines? And with sub-symbolic AI, I mean everything what we have done in machine learning. In sub-symbolic AI, to be more precise, machine learning, there's one technology which is these days very prominent, it's deep learning. It's a key technology, it's the fastest growing field in machine learning, in AI, in the whole computer science. And so there are many success stories of deep learning. This is an example where we used, you heard it, Nico said it, LSTMs, whatever this is, that's for long short-term memories. Here we produce the lens hydrological models for predicting floods and droughts. And we had the best hydrological models, the best climate models until Google hired all my guys and resolved this topic. Now they have our models on this cell phone. You can now in the US look up whether there's drought or floods, whether your house is in danger and stuff like this. That's a Google app, but it's our LSTM models they're using. Also the official flooding models from the US government, Canadian government, Israel government, is our LSTM models. One success story of subsymbolic AI, in this case of neural networks. Another success story is AlphaFold, which was a breakthrough in biology to predict the 3D conformation of proteins. A big thing. There was a Baker group with Rosetta Stone kind of things. They always were leading the predictions, the 3D predictions, and with AlphaFold it changed. And it's really a big issue in biotechnology, medicine, designing new drugs, and understanding what proteins are doing. I will move past on to generative models because most of the newspapers are full of this generative stuff. And I start, I hope I can start, yes, I can start. This is sets poor generated stuff. It's things an AI thought how it can be that somebody is walking in the streets of Tokyo, I would guess. But still there are some giveaways. If now you look at the earrings, as I came closer, and then you see not everything is perfect. Or no, it's I think the sunglasses is. This is a little bit strange. Not everything is perfect here, but it's quite impressive. I go to the next thing, also something from OpenAI, Sora. Some paper planes flying through the wood, poorly generative, made out of thin air, only a text. This was produced. This is diffusion models, or you know, mammoths do not live anymore. Yes, okay. This is a proof that it have to be generated. And, but it's quite impressive that we have this mammoths again. This is what generative AI can do these days. You saw also images get generated by AI. Now we step further and doing this. Here we follow an ant into some caves of ants or some ant hill. And stop. Does anybody of you know how many legs ants have? Should we count it again? How many legs do ants have? Does anybody know?
Seems like four.
Right. How many do you count four, right? You see, if here's something missing, that's the diffusion models. You can glue everything together, but at some point, at a level, you have to decide for legs. And you also have to decide for the number of legs. this system decided for 4 legs. And you're right, ants have 6 legs, as we learned in school. And you see still, there's world knowledge missing. So I can generate something which is quite realistic, but some physics facts might not match. Okay, I jump into the topic. I will talk about XLSM. As I said, I also brought formulas for you, as you asked for it. First of all, ChatGPT is a large language model. What are large language models? Of course, your central race is a neural net. Many parameters, they go up to many billions. These large language models are pre-trained on huge corpora of unlabeled text. And they're pre-trained by self-supervised learning. And there are two kinds how you do it. So BERT system, where you would mask, you have a sentence, you mask out some words, and the model should fill it in again, should predict what's missing. And then a thing which is autoregressive, or causal, you predict the next word in a sentence. You have some text, and you just predict the next word, like you would do with a stock market or something like this. What does this LLM doing? They capture the syntax, they learn how language is constructed, but also the semantics of human language. Semantics, the relation of object, which as a cat can sit on a chair or lie on a chair, whatever. And it learns general knowledge about the world. And perhaps it goes, it can store at some point perhaps all human knowledge. If we are creating the right models. But nowadays, they can memorize large quantities of facts via their training set. One specific model is GPT, Generative Pre-trained Transformers. Oh, you cannot see it because it's hidden, but Transformers, it's these days the most popular large language models. Beside BERT, but now GPT, autoregressive. It's based on the transformer architecture. As I said, pre-trained on a huge data set of unlabeled text. And it's learned in a causal way, in an autoregressive way. You scan some words, and then you predict the next words. And you can use prompts. What's a prompt? You give a context, you give a sequence, you give a prefix, some words, and then the system would continue by predicting the next word. If you predict the next word from nothing, any topic can come. Here you perhaps give some topics by getting this prompt. Later, after you have learned this on this huge data sets, you have to do an alignment to humans. Alignment means it should be friendly, it should be responsive. Like if you ask a question, it should answer the question. And not say, hey, I have also a question for you, or what a stupid question. Should be not toxic, helpful, and so on. And the alignment is done via fine-tuning, where humans rate the responses. This is proper or not, or rank responses, which one is better, which one is worse. Here is an example of ChatGPT. I ask it, who won the Soccer World Cup? And it said it was in 2018, and France won the World Cup. Which is true for 2018. And you have to know GPT, ChatGPT was trained until end of 2021. But I was interested in the new champion of 2022. And this was after this information could go into this version of ChatGPT. Who wants to ask after the 2022 Soccer World Cup? It knew where it was held. Perhaps this was already known in 2021. And it said Brazil, which is a perfect answer. If you don't know, Soccer World Cup in Brazil is a combination which fits very well. That's not bad. But the answer is not right. You see it here. This is a postdoc of Klaus Obermeier's group. No, it's this guy is Lionel Messi. I don't know whether you're in soccer. And these shirts are the Argentinian shirts. Argentina. But you see, if the information did not go into the GPT, it cannot know it. Some drawbacks. Another drawback, I ask a simple question. Give me the largest 5-digit number that contains a 7. you don't have to be super smart in math. What would you do? You would fill everything up with 9s. And in the last place, put a 7, because here it hurts at least. But ChatGPT is like 97,654. Yeah. But that's not correct, try it again. And yeah, also this one. The other 7 contained, but I would place it in a different way. I made it easier. Even the largest 4-digit numbers that contains a 6. The 6 is now in the right place. Cool. But the other numbers should be 9. And that's not good. I played around with this ChatGPT and asked, who is Sepp Hochreiter? and yes, it knew about the LSTM algorithm. But then he, this ChatGPT said he was born on June 4th in Scherding in Austria. Yes. I immediately called my mother and said, did you lie to me? She said I was born in Müller vom Inn and not June 4th. And she said, no, no, it's true what's in your passport. It's true what I told you. Don't trust ChatGPT. And in 1991, as LSTM came, I invented it. But it was too early for my PhD. It's not quite true. University of Toronto. Also, I got some awards, which I never got. But I'm expecting them soon, because if ChatGPT is telling this, yes, I'm confident that I get them. And yes, but you see, there are some errors. But if you see where it's not correct, there's a lot of stuff about LSTM in the Buchreiter, in the training data, that does everything correct. But if there are some facts which are very rare or did not appear often at the internet in some text, it's starting to fantasize stuff. And Scherding is not too bad. If it figured out I have my lab in Linz, Scherding is not far away from Linz, it's in Upper Austria. That would make perfect sense. Also, with my name, Hochreiter is a name which also in this region is not uncommon. But it's not true. I will go into the history. This was some thesis. I'm talking later on XLSTM. But first, I want to give you some historical views. About GPT. That's a GPT series, started 2018, and it went on. This ChatGPT 2022 was then very popular, had impact on the broader public, and yes, and it, this GPT stuff was made by OpenAI. Yeah, let's look who is in OpenAI. This is also a Faunus OpenAI. I don't know this guy, but this is Ilya Sutzkäfer, Wojciech, Wojciech Saramba. John Schulman was very famous in he did some very PPO and stuff like this in reinforcement learning. These guys founded OpenAI, but there were a couple of guys who really did the coding, really developed models in OpenAI. Ilya became very famous with his paper sequence-to-sequence learning, and it was an LSTM thing where you first scan a sentence or a text with LSTM, and then you translate it into another language using the memory of your first part of the LSTM. And this made Ilya Sutzkäfer famous. He was working on LSTMs. Wojciech Saramba, as he founded OpenAI, he was very well known because he used LSTMs for reinforcement learning. And one other guy who joined OpenAI, did a lot in OpenAI, is Andrew Kapasi. He became famous because of a blog. This blog was about LSTMs. This made him famous. Now you see the first guys in OpenAI were LSTM guys. They came all out of the school. I was in close contact with them because they asked me, hey, we got a lot of money, how do we spend it? And then I talked a long time with Ilya about a Turing test, but the Turing test would not convince anybody. With Wojciech, it was going more into robotics. Perhaps robotics would be a convincing application. Then this Dota thing came out because Go was already gone, chess was gone earlier. What is the next more complicated game? It was StarCraft, Dota, but it was more in Asia famous, but I don't know whether it was convincing for the European or American sector. But they want to show they can make a difference. They make some progress in AI. And therefore, they often ask me. And one thing was also this autoregressive language model. It was a side project. It came from the LSTMs and they used transformers, but nobody expected this to boom like it did. Yes, long short term memory, LSTM. I did it in my diploma thesis in the beginning of 2011, 2012. It boomed. It was in every cell phone. Every company, you see, as it's now is called Meta, Microsoft, Amazon, Google, Apple. So I used it as their main technology for language, sometimes speech. It was in Siri and whatever. And this was 2017, LSTM, all language models were built with LSTMs. This is a history. And then something happened. There was this NeurIPS paper, attention is all you need. And these guys showed me this, told me this. The attention already existed, but the attentions are together with LSTMs. You used LSTMs, but you have a separate mechanism to look back. And these guys told me, hey, forget about your LSTMs, you only look back. Yes. And this worked. And if you do that, you can do everything much faster because you can do it in parallel. You can process all words in parallel, you're much faster, you can push through a model much more text data at the same time. This is the architecture, I don't tell you, go into the details. This is the attention module, that's the core of the transformer architecture. That's attention, that's this module. And out of this attention module, you build these blocks, and then you stack the blocks and have these big models, which were super successful. 2017. LSTM was gone. Everybody used now transformers for speech, for language, for everything. But now I go into this little bit thing. Attention, if you look at the memory, it has for memory two matrices. That's the matrices of keys and the matrix of values. And if you see here, this matrix always have a dimension, I call it L. L is the sequence length, the context length, the number of words. If you have longer sequences, you have larger matrices. Here you add always a column for each token more. Here you add a row for each token more. So memory increases. You store everything precisely. And that's how the memory increases. If this is the memory, now you get to L plus one, you add this column vector at the end of the matrix. You add this vector as a row vector at the end of this matrix. That's how memory is updated, how memory increases. So memory depends on the sequence length, on L. The number of words, the number of tokens. The context. And this is the famous attention formula. It's for one query. At some point you have a query. You have key and values. You do this operation, so it's basically a dot product of the query with all keys, with all tokens you saw earlier. Some scaling factor and the softmax out of it. And now you weight all values by the softmax. So softmax has 0.5 on component 4, then the value at 4 is weighted. That's what attention is doing. What are the disadvantages of these transformers? Most prominent, the transformer is quadratic in the sequence length. Why is that? For each query, if you go back, for each query, for each new word, you have to look at all previous words. It's like filling up a triangular matrix. And this is quadratic in the context length. It's quadratic in compute and linear in the context length in the memory you have to store. The other disadvantage is you only have pairwise interactions. This is this Q, only makes a dot product to K1, this Q makes a dot product with K2, Q makes a dot product with K3 and so on. It's only this dot product between a query and keys. But not three vectors see each other, query with two keys or something like this. That's not what's happening here. There are only pairwise interactions, dot product of embeddings. We already know this pairwise interactions from support vector machines. Is this a question?
Yes. You're saying no complex interaction. I agree with you that there are no complex interaction in one block. But once you stack the blocks, the interactions come.
Yes, that's true. You over the blocks, you get interactions. But this is also limited. Depending on how many blocks you do, how much you stack, you also can exhaust things if the interactions get more and more complex. At some point, also transformer, I will show you an example, cannot do it across all blocks. But still, many things can be learned by doing more blocks. But also here, the complexity is limited. And there are no abstractions. Abstractions, where LSTM is good. It has this scalar memory cells. All words which are similar with some respect contribute to this scalar memory. Perhaps all things having to do with sports or with cats or with kitchen, I don't know, reinforce this kitchen neuron, perhaps. But we don't know which words were there, but you know there was something about kitchen. The LSTMs were super, super strong, but it wasn't sufficient to generate good text, because sometimes you really have to memorize what word was there and not only abstractions. Yes? Coming to XLSTM, first of all, how good is LSTM? First of all, LSTM has stood the test of time. It has been used for many applications. You saw an application with hydrology. It was a Nature paper this year. There was another Nature paper of DeepMind about fusion controls. They also used an LSTM. And also the reinforcement learning stuff. It was used and is still used for some applications. So concept of LSTMs is not too far off. Led to numerous deep learning success stories, early in language, but then later not language anymore, but reinforcement learning and so on. And so, yeah, the first large language models. Should we look back? Should we revisit these LSTMs? And we ask a simple question. How far can we get in language modeling when making LSTM large, building large models with billions of parameters using latest techniques from LLMs, like residual stacking, stuff like this ResNet kind of architecture, which was very successful for the transformers, and mitigating known limitations. There are some limitations I knew, but if we get rid of these limitations, then perhaps everything is fine. First of all, what is LSTM? LSTM, the basic architecture is the memory cell. And the memory cell has two ingredients. The first one is a constant error carousel. The other one is gating. The constant error carousel is just the next state is equal to the old state plus something. Therefore, you have a constant error backflow because the derivative of ct with respect to ct minus 1 is 1. Forget about this gating. In this case, it would be ft. Forget gate. That's the first thing. To have a very nice Jacobian with ones on the main diagonal. That's the constant error carousel. Since FT would be one, the derivative of the next state with the previous state is one. But then you add something. The other thing is gating, where we have three gates, the input gate, the output gate and the forget gate. So forget gate a little bit destroys the constant error carousel because now the derivative is not one anymore. If the forget gate is close to one, it still is fine. These were the two main ideas of LSTMs in 1991 in my diploma thesis. Gating, one, two, three gates, forget gate. So forget gate came later to be more precise. The input gate and the output gate were from the beginning. The forget gate was later introduced by Felix Gehrs a couple of years later. But this forget gate also destroys a little bit the constant error carousel. But I still include it. This these are the LSTM ideas. And this is the LSTM in the scalar notation, in the original notation. You see many notations, vector notations, but the first thing was only looking at one memory cell. We have the CT, we already know this formula, and then OT, the output gate, times the hidden, what is the hidden is the memory cell, a squashing activation function, a normalization function, I always call it a normalization function, and so forth and so on. But I don't go to these formulas. These are standard LSTM formulas, where you have also for what's coming in into the set, what's coming in into the memory cell, you have some activation function, typically it's phi, psi, tang h, and then you have the gates, and all gating are sigmoids. Sigmoid means so between 0 and 1. And all gates depend on the input, on the previous hidden states, yes, this previous age, the thing which goes out of some memory cell, and perhaps some bias. That's a pre-activation. It's a tilde here. And then applying to this pre-activation of the gates, the sigmoid gives you the activation of the gates. And the gates are multiplied to the old cell content, to the new input, and to the normalized cell state to feed to itself via here or to the output or whatever. That's a standard LSTM notation in scalar. There's out the vector notation, but the original notation was scalar. And now coming to LSTM limitations. There are huge limitations. I saw first the inability to revise storage decisions. I will show this at the nearest neighbor search. There's a forget gate. And as Felix and Jürgen introduced it, actually I proposed it. And there was a phone call. Because Jürgen said, is there a problem? Yes, LSTM cannot forget anything anymore. If you store something, it will stay forever. And then the idea is to introduce a forget gate. But the problem is you can never learn storing and forgetting. Because if you have learned storing, if you learn a little bit forgetting, you also learn many, many storing procedures. If you store with 0.99, if you go to 0.96, then you have 0.96, 0.96, 0.96, and you unlearn the memory. Therefore, learning forgetting means unlearning memory, and therefore you never learn forgetting. But it still was successful, forget gate for short sequence. For long sequence, it cannot work, because there's no solution passed to a good solution with this. So forget gate would be the thing where you can say I stored something, but it was wrong. But the forget gate cannot learn this. And that was always a problem. If you do something sequentially, you stored something and said, no, I stored the wrong thing. I want to store this one. How you do this? So that was a big problem I thought a long time. Then the LSTM has limit storage capacities, I already showed you. It's good in abstraction. It has the singular values, but it cannot precisely store the words which were earlier. It can store, yes, there were some words about sports, some words about cats, but not the precise words. And a big problem is parallelization. Transformers were just faster and therefore more successful. First limitation, I want to show it with a nearest neighbor search. You have a reference vector, and now you have a sequence of vectors, and you scan the sequence of vectors sequentially. And you look for the most similar vector. And for each vector in this sequence, there's an attached value, there's a value. It's a random value attached to it. And what you should do at sequence n, you should provide the value which was attached to the most similar vector to the reference vector. That's revising stored decisions, because you have to revise the value you stored, which you have to give out, if you find a more similar vector. And also you have to revise what is the highest similarity up to now. There are two things you have to revise. You find a more similar vector, then you have to store the similarity, and you have to store the value because you have to provide it at the end. But if there is a new vector, you can throw everything away, because the value attached can be much higher, much lower, you don't know what this value is. And transformer are doing good. So look at the whole sequence, say here's the most similar thing, pick out the value. But we do sequentially. Now we have a very similar one, we store everything, and then we find a more similar one. And now we can throw everything away. And with the forget-get, it doesn't work. You saw now why I got white hairs because of this problem. And if you do some experiments with this very simple task, you see the LSTM is not very good. Transformer very good, because so in retrospective, they look at the whole sequence at the same time and say, I have a query, I look for the most similar key, so I designed for this. But our XLSTM, which I will introduce, is mitigating this problem. It's much better in this very simple task, because now we'll show you, found a solution for this. And the solution is exponential gating. What we are doing, the first big idea is exponential gating, which sounds stupid, because you have, use an exponential function, not a sigmoid or stuff like this, you use an exponential function, but you do also normalization. And for example, do I have this example? No, I don't have this example. You have an exponential gate for the input gate, for example. And now an input comes which is more important for you. You do an exponentially high value for the input gate and scale everything down. Therefore, the new value remains, but all old values are scaled down. I show it here. Therefore, we have this we know, but we have a normalizer state. A normalizer state that comes in here, which is collecting all inputs. This is forget-gate all inputs, and this new input. If now I put it down here, if you want only to attend to the latest input, the current input, if the input gate would go to infinity, then this hidden state, Ct, this is almost infinity, nt is only since it, since it cancels out, you would stick with zt. The idea is, if this guy is large, and you divide by it, this guy is equally large, then you put attention to the most current input. Then you can say, I throw everything away, what I memorized until now, by scaling this up. Because by scaling this up and then normalizing here, you get rid of all the old values. We thought the forget gate can do this. The forget gate cannot do it. The forget gate cannot learn to downweight these old values. Because if you're a little bit downweighted, then you also do it again, 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 and you learn to forget. If you start to learn to forget, you cannot memorize anymore. That's a contradicting goal, and this does not work. But with exponential gating, we have a real forgetting mechanism, by updating the current input, normalizing everything, and only the current input remains. And here we see it, exponential input gate. We can also do exponential forget gate. We also tried this. This also works. Exponential input gate was very important for the forget gate. You can still use the SIGMET or exponential both are working to some extent. Yes, new is the normalizer state. You do this exponential. You have to keep track of all this weighting, and then you do a normalizing. Then it's a weighted sum, more or less. Yes, everything else remains the same. We don't have here what I told you in the normal LSTM. I called it normalizing function or squashing function, normalizing function. And we replace this now by direct normalization. Therefore, the cell state does not explode. And we have the ability by a very high value to override it. And if you have a very high value, and now something more important comes, we can still increase it. The exponential function still allows to give even higher values. With exponential gating, we solve this problem of revising storage decision. Transformer doesn't have this because transformer is looking at the whole sequence. LSTM has to go step by step. Now I have to make a decision. Is it important? I give a weight of 0.5. Now another thing comes, oh, I should give a weight of 5 because it's more important. It's 5 times more important than the other one. But I cannot give a weight of 5 because the input gate doesn't allow that. This is now better. There we have this S-LSTM. The new version here is a scalar LSTM, S-LSTM. The memory is just a vector. Every entry in this memory vector is, corresponds to a memory cell. So memory capacity is M divided by D. D is a hidden state. If you want to store vectors of length D, then you can store M divided by D vectors, more or less. The interesting stuff is the memory is independent of the sequence length, and it's independent of the hidden dimensions, the vectors you want to store. So token embedding or whatever. That's good, but it only solves one aspect, and this is revising the decisions. What you also have to do, because you have now this exponential gating, you have to do some kind of stabilization, where you take the max of log ft, log it, and so on. You keep the exponent low, because basically you divide here ct, nt, both have ft, it. If you lower this one, lower this one by the same factor, lower this one by the same factor, lower this one by the same factor, everything would cancel out at this operation. If the exponent is too high, lower the exponent for this guy, for this guy, for this guy, for this guy, and everything would be fine. It cancels out. That's done here in a interesting way because you roll it out, but it's important to do stabilization. If you work with exponential functions, you get large exponents and your program complains at some point. Okay, I made a check mark here. I said to revise storage decisions. This was something I had problems for many, many years. I solved this problem of mine. But there are still problems. The limited storage capacity and the parallelization problem. Okay, let's look at those. What we did, we looked at a language thing. It was Rare Token, it's a Rare Token prediction. we computed the perplexity on token distribution on Wikitext 103, standard data set. Wiki, it's very interesting because here LSTM really had problems many, many years ago, 2015-16, because in Wikipedia there are some words which are very rare. They only appear in Wikipedia because they are about some specific topics from history or from art or whatever. And therefore Wiki is the text which has these rare tokens. And this was training different models, LSTMs, Transformer, XLSTM, on rare token prediction. And this are some buckets, bins of tokens, say less than, I think it was 1,000, less than 10, or between 1,000 and 10,000, larger than 10,000 and so on. So there were different buckets. And you always see LSTM was not good in rare tokens. It cannot be good in rare tokens because it did not learn to extract features from rare tokens. It had to have to learn what to extract. If a token doesn't appear often enough in the training set, it has no idea how to store it, how to deal with it. It has to learn to store. If you store something in a Scala, you have to extract something which you store. And you have to learn that this token should look like other tokens where you extract the same characteristics. If the token appears very seldom, you don't learn the right embedding, you don't learn to extract the right stuff. Transformer, on the contrary, stores the token, whatever embedding it had. And later can look back, was this token present, can look for this token. And the XLSTM also solves this now, is even sometimes better than Transformer. It's about memorization. If you have, either you learn to memorize something, then the token have to be very frequent, or you just store it somehow. Then you can look in your memory and pull it out. Limit storage capacities. The solution is a new memory structure. We used a matrix memory. It's a covariance update rule. This covariance update rule is under some constraints the best thing you can do if you have a memory retrieval only by a dot product, by a matrix vector product, stuff like this. The covariance update rule was shown, to be precise, only for the binary case, but still was shown to the best thing you can do. The idea is to use a whole matrix. You remember there was a small C there, always, and now the idea is, instead of this C, we do a capital C, capitalizing. What this means is the whole matrix. The matrix is the old matrix plus something. And this is also a matrix, it's an outer product, it's a rank one matrix, it's fine. It's a memory retrieval, it's just the matrix times a query vector. And now you see we have the same, like with Transformer, we have values, we have keys, we have queries. I don't know whether we call them like, because it's well known for the Transformer, but it's just, if you want to have a memory, you can do this. And actually, this kind of memory is already known. It's a classical Hopfield network. It's a Hopfield network with I don't know, a covariance update rule or a HAP rule, however, I don't know what they like to call it. It's a bidirectional memory. Hopfield would be V transpose, something like this. It's a bidirectional memory, but it's the same principle. And this update rule was shown in the 70s, especially for binary vectors, it's the best you can do. Now, here the MLSTM from memory LSTM. Here you have my new update rule. But this is the vectors and you have the outer product. This we know already is a normalized state from exponential gating, because we still have here exponential gating. And now this is a little bit more complex, because the memory retrieval was would be what we also call query like in transformer time C. But now we want to normalize it, and normalizing by n this times q, this thing could be close to zero or even be negative. Therefore, we have to be careful for the normalization. Previously, it was no problem, because in the SLSTM, the normalization was always a positive number. You have f times old normalization. F was a positive gate, or exponential function is also positive, plus the other gate, input gate. It's either sigmoid or exponential. You always have positive numbers. Yet more and more and more and more. Here, this stuff, if you have keys, could be small, negative, or whatever. Therefore, that would be the normalization, but what we do now first takes the absolute value and lower bounded by one. Should not be below one. That's the thing. We want to do normalization, but the normalization can break everything because you can divide by something which is close to zero. Therefore, normalization have been taken care of here. And then there's one thing, the output gate. This gate as scalars. The output gate is a vector, meaning whatever we get out here, each component get a different output gate multiplied to. That's also one particularity. Then this is queries key values. Here is pre-activations. And what you see here, nothing depend on the previous hidden states. Nothing depend on HT minus one. The hidden connections are gone. One second. Because the hidden connections are gone, this stuff can be parallelized. It can be parallelized exactly like flash attention. We couldn't do it, we didn't have the time to do it, but it can be parallelized like flash attention, exactly the same thing. But we have to throw away the hidden question.
Yeah, so how do you handle the max question for backward pass?
First of all, you can replace it by how it's called LSE. Some exponential, but what we did, we make propagate through straight through what we did, but
so
we
you pretend there's always a gradient, but not in the forward pass. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And normally, this very seldom comes into place. Normally, this is nice because the query hits one key after learning and so on, but yes, always we ignore it. We played around with log sum exponential, like an approximation, a continuous approximation of the maximum function. It also works, but it's just more complex, and this gave us almost the same results. Yes, we stick with this, but it's not put in stone. If you find out some approximation, continuous approximation of the maximum is better.
Yes.
We didn't see a difference. But important, no dependence on the previous hidden state. Now we throw something away. The SLSM still has the hidden, which is important. The new hidden state, also the gates, depend on the old hidden state. Here, everything depends on the input, but no more on the old hidden state, which gives us the possibility to parallelize it. Here we can use, and actually my guys are working on this, you can do flash attention. But we have to implement it for this thing. MLSTM is a matrix LSTM. There's a whole matrix memory. It's a D times D memory. It's a memory, it's a huge memory, perhaps. It's a D times D memory. It's home field like, bidirectional memory like. We went back, also memory capacity for Hopfield is 0.14 times D, we know this. There are some things, but this memory does not increase. If the sequence length is 1,000, 1 million, you always have this memory. Of course, the information might overlap, get superimposed, but we can, in advance, fix the memory. So memory is independent of the sequence length. But it's depending on the size of the vectors you want to store. This was with exponential gating. This was with matrix memory. And by skipping the hidden connection, we now also got some parallelization, CUDA kernel-like. To be honest, we did a very fast parallel version, but we did not implement flash attention because that was too much at this time. But in principle, we can do it. There's no thing. But we cannot do it for the SLSTM because there's this hidden connection. Here we always have to work sequentially. How does XLSTM look like? I showed you this new SLSTM memory cells. They go into blocks. And by stacking these blocks, we get an XLSTM architecture. I show you the blocks. This is, we use it typically for SLSTM. It's more like a transformer block. I don't go into it. Here we have the self-attention, we do an SLSTM. Then later we do the MLP, up projection, NILU, down projection, something like this. This architecture we say post-up projection. Because the idea is we want to go in a high dimensional space. But in this high dimensional space, we have some summarization of the past, some summarization of the history. We want to go in a high dimensional space because here we can distinguish different paths. I have to predict this word. If I have this path, this is the next word of this path. I have to separate different paths. And separating different paths is, from Kaffer's theorem, better if we go in a high dimensional space in a non-linear way. That's post-up projection. We have also pre-up projection, which we use for MLSTM in particular. We go first in a high dimensional space by this thing, and then later project down. And in this high dimensional space, we do this memory LSTM. And this memory LSTM is, up projection helps because if we project up, we increase the dimension, therefore we can store more. That's a good thing to increase, go in high dimensional space, build this storage matrix, this Hopfield or associative memory, and then go down in the dimension. Two differences, up projection, doing some summarization of the past in a nonlinear way and then project down. Here, first we do some summarization of the past, also in a nonlinear way, then we linearly project up, and then we have here a nonlinearity. Therefore, we are in a high dimensional space, and try to separate different paths. Because to predict the next word, what we have to do is to see, was it this path or this path? Because then I would predict this word or this word. That's the whole art with the stuff. Summarizing the past, distinguish different past, and then you can memorize text. This is how you memorize all these facts. That's one. And then we have these two blocks, with an ML list here, an SL list here, and now we can stack different blocks. What we do is XLSM AB means we have a ratio of A divided by B of ML stems to SL stems. We always do more ML stem because storing is much more important than this hidden interaction. And yeah, now I show you some results. I don't go to everything, but only look at the parity problem. Do you know what a parity problem is? You have a string of 0 and 1s. If the 1s are odd, then you give out a 1. If the number of 1s is even, you give out a 0. The best thing is you memorize your past state, say whether there were odd or even 1s, and if a 1 comes, you switch it. If a 0 comes, you stick with your state. That's something like state tracking. If you have access to your previous state, your previous memory, you can solve the parity very good. And you see, LSTM can solve it, different LSTM in a block, a poor LSTM. Then we have XLSTM, 0, 1 means this is only SLSTM, 0 part of MLSTM, SLSTM. And here we have only MLSTMs. But here we don't have the hidden. And you see, it fails. And if we do both, it works again. If we do an SLSM block and then on top MLSM block or vice versa, it works. But you also see Llama, that's some transformer model, cannot do it. Mamba, state space model, cannot do it. And there are different methods. RWKB6. Doesn't quite good job, but this is a question.
What does solving the parity problem imply, like for these models?
I want to show with the SLSTM, we have a more I said this pairwise interactions. I said with the SLSTM we have a more complex model. We know this parity problem is a state tracking problem, and in theory, I know with the layers, you already said with the layers, you can recover some of this, but if the string is long enough, also these layers help no longer, because you cannot do state tracking. You have to memorize your old state to generate a new state. And this is, there are theoretical proofs that transformers are not capable of this, that state space models are not capable of this, but recurrent neural networks are capable of this. If RWKB here is not good, but in principle, it's always here you see, it's the second best sometimes. There are limitations on the computational complexity of transformers and state space models. And if we don't include an SLSTM, then we also fail. But it's from the theory known. We only want to show here, hey, really the SLSTM gives you some addition because it was unclear, does the SLSTM help? Because for language, it looks like it does not help. But it could be there are some tasks where you need the state tracking. You have to memorize your old state to generate a new state. And therefore you can solve more complex tasks like regular languages. Regular languages cannot be, in general, be solved by transformers or state space models. They are theoretical concepts. And we only want to show it can help to have this hidden connection. The hidden connections slow us down tremendously, but give us more complexity, more power, can build more complex models. The second thing we tested is the memory of the new X-LSTM compared to some other memories, MAMA, RB, WKV, and so on. We never can beat transformers because memorizing something, transformers as a gold standard, we can never do. For a needle in a haystack thing, transformers are perfect. We have no chance. Therefore, memorizing something, LAM is almost the best. What is this? It's a multi-query associative recall task for each sequence. We select randomly some key value pairs from a very large vocabulary, and we have to memorize this. We have later to provide the right value if the key appears again. You have to store a lot of stuff. If you store everything, you can solve it. Transformers can store everything much better than we in having a very precise memory. But we are then better than Mamba or other recurrent neural network RWKV 5.6. 4 we did not use because 5 and 6 also have some memory, have some structure like covariance update rule. And here you see the violet thing, LSTM can solve it. Even this is a memory LSTM, that's a LSTM which memory N and this hidden interaction, it's even better to use both. But also the other thing, oh, it's a top of just you see it starting here. The other one, the memory alone, helps. But if you combine memory, here it breaks down, but here it's up again, here it's good. The combination of both even has synergetic effects. What I want to show here is we have better memory than Mamba, than the state space model. We have better memory than other recurrent networks like RWKV. Now I'm only a couple of slides and I'm done. I do it the first time, therefore my time management is not the best. It's a comparison. We compared on Slim Pyjama only 15 billion tokens, some models, GPT-3, LAMA, H3, Mamba. This is a transformers, this is a state space models, this are many other models, convolutional based models and recurrent neural network based models and so on. And then so two LSTMs. Here you see Mamba is super competitive. We are better with both models, but the memory alone model is a little bit better. But Mamba, the state space model, on this, it's a language task. PPL is how good your perplexity, how good your is the next word prediction. And what's underlined is the best method from the corresponding category. LAMA was the best transformer model, only slightly. MAMA was the best state space model, and RWKV4 was the best linear models in recurrent neural networks. And here, the result again, but now only with the best from each category, you see the different model sizes, 125 million, 350 million parameters, 760 million parameters, 1.3 billion parameters, and 2.7 billion parameters. Here also the XLSM broke, didn't go down anymore because it was undertrained. It has not enough training data. But this was one result. It's only showing comparison. We now have our favorites. And what we do next, first comes this slide. I show you the result on a much larger data set. Okay, this is sequence extrapolation. On here, it's already on Slim Pyjama 300 billion tokens, and this was on 15 billion tokens. These were only small experiments. These were now large experiments. You know, for these experiments, we invested the last 3 months 10 million euros. Only drew these experiments. I set it up. It was a huge investment to do it properly. And this is only sequence. We have context lengths of 2048. And then in test, you went up to 16,000 context lengths. That's the model breakdown or not. And here we are super good. I did not expect this. I thought LSTMB with the forget gate, it will not survive. But it did better than many of the other methods. Even if you learn only on short sequences, you can extrapolate to long sequences. This result I did not expect, to be honest, yes?
Yeah, so because of this extrapolation result, I'm wondering what might be the minimal context that you need to still have a useful model. Because I mean, if you extrapolate well, you could spend less in training while using shorter context. Have you tried?
No, we have tried almost nothing. Only for this couple of runs, there are only a few runs. It's 10 million euros. If you give me another couple of 100 million.
Those would be cheaper. That's why I'm asking.
Yeah, but if you give me so, for 5 million euros, we do it. Much cheaper. Now we focus on only, we had so many ideas, and I have to keep down and say, okay, this idea costs you now 500,000 euros. Do you want to do it or not? If it doesn't work, you grant 500,000 euros. Even if one night the GPU, the cluster is empty for one day, it was, I think, 56 or 58,000 euros. It's like a small car. Okay, if you don't fill your GPUs, a car is gone. And some of the guys were under pressure, yes?
maybe, so I'm not sure about the economics of GPT and the performance, because there was a, I think it costs around 1 billion in the end to do this GPT training at all. So, but I asked myself, are there, because we're in a research area, I think, currently, so we have to think about more money than, let's say, OpenAI. So, do you think how to economize the LSTM, ex-LSTM training to get more bang for a buck?
To get more what?
More explosion for a 1 euro cent. Kind of, I think that's the kind of more bomb. So it means more like to be more to have a better training for the same amount of money.
A better training or in inference? Because in inference we are linear and they're not. Also we can do the same thing with less compute. We can do it faster. We can accommodate more users at the same time on the same thing. So we're best because we are linear. Mm-hmm. Transform is quadratic.
I mean more in general to run some experiments, more economized by changing architecture.
But for training, we are not, because for training, also with the SLSM, we are still expensive.
Okay.
But in inference, we are cheaper.
Okay.
Because also, the transformer have to make a new word and fit everything into a new word. We do it linearly. But because of this flash attention kind of stuff and stuff in training, except the context length is in training very huge, then we also win in training. But normally, we win in inference.
Okay.
Yes, that's length extrapolation, which is also good. Perhaps it pays off at some point, yeah. But right now we, and okay, perhaps, because I did not understand this. The question is also, how do we do a campus to the next step? And for the next step, we need money. We need money to give it to AWS. So that I can become richer. And this is on the three, on the big data set, and this is where the 10 million flow in, most of the money, is to some comparison. Now on 300 billion tokens of Llama, Mamba, RWKV, XSDM. And these were the favorites from our comparison on a smaller data set. And this is the scaling laws. And we want to show this scaling laws to investors and ask, can we make the line longer? And we need perhaps 100 or 200 million euros, and probably we already have it, to make the lines longer. But that's a game. It's not science anymore. It's also getting some money for compute. And we need now at least 100 million euros, perhaps a little bit more, to extend our lines here.
You could ask, leave the questions to the end then. Let's just finish this up, maybe.
That's never finished. This is the most important slides we want to show the investors. This already models, if you can do it longer, larger, you can make it to a product. If we have a 7 billion model, Mistral has a 7 billion models, be in the game. And this is a slide where we ask for new money. And it's also scientifically interesting, but for us it's also some money to proceed the research. Some SLM limitations, I do it very fast. Our SLSM cannot be parallelized. It's 6 times 1.5 times slower than our MLSM, and our MLSM is also not the fastest, as MLSM are not optimized. They are 4 times slower than flash attention, but we can do the flash attention idea. And we did not have the time to implement the flash attention, but we do it now, because if we get the new money, if we are 4 times faster, we are 4 times cheaper, and instead of 400 million euros, we only need 100 million euros. Therefore, we have to do that. The matrix memory is computationally expensive. I don't use weights for the matrix memory, but I still have the flops for it. We are better in memory, but we have to do, it's computationally more expensive. But it's not a problem, because you can parallelize all this. Because we do it on the GPU, we can parallelize it. And therefore, we need more flops, but we do it in parallel. Initialization of the fork gate, you have to be chosen for, carefully. We have still a limited memory. If we so sequence length is longer and longer, and more things are stored, our memory is limited. It's D times D. And of course, we didn't have money, time, or anything else to optimize this stuff. The transformer is out for 7 years. There are these Google guys, these Meta guys, Microsoft guys, OpenAI guys, Amazon guys, Baidu guys. All those have optimized this transformer architecture. We are at the beginning. There are so many ideas where we can improve, where we can do better. It's only the starting. There's a lot of space left to improve. XLSM exponential gating was important. The memory structure, the matrix memory was important. Right now, LSTM performs good compared to other models, especially state space models were very competitive. Mamba was our most competitive method. As the scaling laws tell us, we believe that with larger LSTMs, XLSTMs, we can still be better than everything which is out right now. We can be better than transformers or state space models. And we will try it out. And this is my last slide. Next, we want to build larger models. 7 billion, 30 billion. But we first have to get some money for that. Then we want to identify application areas. The XLSM is even better, perhaps even with this SLSM state tracking property. Perhaps there are some areas where we are very good. We don't have, we didn't explore all the stuff. We now concentrate on standard language attacks. And most important, we want to explore more this new XLSTM idea. We still started, so many ideas, and I was just saying, no, Kubinian, don't try it out. Max, no, no, let's do this. It was so hard. So I couldn't publish, so we're working there. I said, can we submit something to NeurIPS? No, you're not allowed. You have to work here. Please, Seb, can you have a PhD? No, you don't get a PhD. You have to work here. That was kind of frustrating, and they want to explore, but we have to push this to get the next financing round to have some money to compete with the big companies. And that's the end. Thank you.